So today we'll have a look at a song from Beauty and the Beast, classical Disney. And it's good to discuss classical, clever, ancient poetry, but sometimes we need to look at something that is closer to us, because not everybody reads the Psalms. I guess not many people do, in fact, or pay attention to them. But Disney songs, that's something that everybody knows. So it's interesting to see how they may reflect who we are, where we are. Because if you look at Disney films, then they're not always really good, not always really good for children. And again, it tells us something. So you have not seen this classical cartoon, right? So let's start.
No, I haven't.
No, you haven't. Okay. So do you know the story of Beauty and the Beast in general?
I think I do.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the story goes as follows. There's a beauty, and in some versions, she has, at least in the version I know, she has two sisters.
Mm-hmm. Well, the French version just has the girl. Okay.
The French version just has the girl, but it's not really important because what I know is the Russian version, so I might try and remember the Russian version.
It's really the same story. It's not. There's
it's
no difference.
The same story. Okay. There's no.
Apart
no
from the sisters.
Yeah, and of course the culminating point in the story is the Beast's transformation.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks to the Beauty's love.
Mm-hmm.
And understanding, the Beast gets transformed into a beautiful prince.
Yeah.
And then they get married, I understand, and live happily ever after.
Yeah. So obviously the story happens in between. Before they get married.
And before they are happy making. Because somehow both of them feel certain want in their lives. There's something like it.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So Disney obviously needs to make it more dramatic, more action like. So let's go through it quickly. Okay. Let's share the screen.
Oh, you're going to share the screen.
Yeah. So here we have the girl who's called Belle. Surprise, surprise. And it's really, really conspicuous. It's how the film starts is this girl is walking through her town. It's a small town, you can see it. But you pay attention to the details and you see straight away from the very first seconds of the film. It's a little bit. So here's the girl. You can see she loves books. You see her with a book. She's all in white.
Except the apron.
Yeah, but it's a light color, light blue and white. And as she walks through the town, she meets lots and lots of people. They're all good, hard-working people, and they're all ugly. They're all fat, they have strange faces, they have ugly faces. She is the only one who looks normal. Let's see. So I'm not showing you all of them. You can just watch it later if you like, just some bits from it. So she's all in white.
Okay.
She has her book. She pretends to be very highbrow. although really she's not different. So you can see old ladies who are like, oh, what is she doing? She's reading a book. How could she? And you see, she's like, oh, I'm all intellectual, but not really. You can see how she's kind of flirting at the same time. And she's like, oh, I'm not like you. I'm not like you. Then we
I'm
have.
not one of you.
Yeah, so she walks through the town and it's all down to earth, plain, ugly people. If you have children there, connected with like pigs. You see, there's a boy who's running after the pig, and then a second later, there's a pig running after that boy. So he doesn't look very nice. And you just look at them, you compare them, you see the proportions, the colors, the lines, and she's like, oh, I'm not from this place. I'm so much better than you, baby. So the only girls who look more or less normal are connected with like sexual bits, as you can see here. Again, it's supposed to be a children's cartoon. You have you have pictures like this, where you see there's a man who looks right at this woman's boobs, giving her some meat, and right behind him there's his wife, who looks really ugly like a man. She looks like a man. She's angry. She wants to hit him. Yeah, but that's his wife, his real wife. So that goes through all the film, really. Again and again, you see how if it's a wife, a good wife, a real wife, then she's always ugly, horrible. It's you don't want to be a wife because a wife looks like this. And if it's a normal-looking girl, then she has big boobs, and that's the only point of her being around. So either you are pretty with boobs, and you are here to please males, or you're a wife, you are moral, let's say, but you're ugly and angry, and you're very much unhappy. So how if you're a girl and you're watching it, maybe you're not paying attention to it consciously, but it all gets recorded on your let's say subconsciousness, if you believe in subconsciousness. It's not only in that cartoon, it's like a recurring theme in different Disney cartoons if you look closely. So then you can see now the example of a good wife. So as you can see, she looks ugly. She has lots of children who looks like little pigs, little animals. And Belle just goes past and she's like, oh, I'm all in white. I'll never be like you. So it's like, will a girl want to be a wife and have a normal family with children if she sees images like that? There's another one. So it's like a moral, if you're a wife, then you're really unhappy, fat, ugly. Look at the hen. Always. Okay. And she's like, oh, I'm all happy. I'm all running to a book, to the bookseller. Hooray! So we can almost see her knickers as she runs into the bookstore. She's so happy. And then she gets a new book and she like goes through the town reading it. She doesn't look at the town like I'm not with you. And all the dirt of that world does not concern her like the dirty water. I'm all in white, I'm all in white. So there's some more characters. This lady is like almost pretty, really. Yeah, that guy should must be Scottish. So the whole town is full of freaks, except her. Then we see the man. the man. That's his name is Gaston. He's again, you look at those films, Disney and some other films too, and always if you have a man, or the idea of being manly is to be masculine, is to have muscles, is to be like an animal, like a beast. Again, you just get tired looking at all this big strong man. And of course the first thing we see as we meet Gaston is his muscles, his hands, and a very big gun, because he doesn't have brains, he's just all muscles. He thinks he's really handsome and cool, and he looks kind of handsome. So he's like, I'm alpha. Okay, so that's another shot of him. So obviously he has a funny supporting character here. Again, something that Disney does all the time. If you have a big strong hero or an anti-hero or villain, then you give them a funny supporting character. That's the first time we see the beast. So you see, they're not really that different. They even have the same kind of eyes, blue eyes here and blue eyes here. So what happens is Gaston wants to have Belle as his wife, and she's like, no, you're too stupid for me, you big muscular man. And she ends up being with the beast instead. So what's the difference between them? Is a difference of the beast, the prince. Well, he had his time to think about what he's done in his life, because what's inside him is now apparent, is on his, well, face, let's say, in his appearance, while Gaston is like that prince in the beginning. He's just very arrogant, self-assured. But the prince was exactly the same, there was no difference between them really. So the only reason why Belle kind of decides to stay with the beast is because, oh, but it's so romantic, he lives in a castle. And Gaston only goes to pubs. Again, the question is, if you believe, I'm not saying it's true, maybe it's a very stupid idea. I think it's a very stupid idea anyway. If you believe that a person can change another person, like the beauty can change the beast, then she could just equally successfully change Gaston. Right?
Oh, yes.
Maybe he needs more help than the beast, because the beast has already learned his lesson, while Gaston is just stupid. He just doesn't know he's wrong, if he's wrong. Because if he was turned into the beast, then what would have happened? Maybe he would just become an animal. I mean, it's not an equal position. Because the beast is a prince, and he has his palace, he has lots of servants, he has his, like, upbringing. While Gaston doesn't really have anything, he just has stupid followers to make him feel better. Okay, then again, the beast, as you can see, is not nice. That's why he's the beast. And the first time we see him, really, he's all angry, snapping. Being like a big animal again, and not different from Gaston, who's at least kind of trying to, or not, at least he thinks he is nice, at least he thinks he is cool, while the beast is just very much angry and unhappy. And again, you see how here being a man means like being an animal. Yeah, so he's kind of cool. You can see it in his eyes, like he looks at him. But he's an animal. He's a big and strong animal, and in that sense, he's not much different from Gaston again. Okay, oh yeah. So you may think that maybe Tarzan is another example of a man being an animal. You may think that maybe Tarzan is the same as the beast, as Gaston, because he's strong, he lives with animals, oops, and he has blue eyes, but I guess it's a different story. Look, Jane here, the girl here, she has the same kind of dress as Belle, her signature dress here. But it's very different stories, because if you think about Tarzan, then even though he was living with the gorillas, it was like a society. And there was friendship, there was kindness, there was some moral aspect to the society, even though it was like animals. It's like the whole point of that film to show that maybe sometimes animals have more empathy than humans. But still, again, of course, there is like a man has muscles and is a little bit like an animal. The same story. Although it's much nicer than Beauty and the Beast. Okay. So that's another example of how if you have a pretty girl, it's only to see her knickers. So all pretty girls in that cartoon are here to please big strong males, or not big strong, but males. So you compare these blondes with the women from the town. Yeah, so that's the same kind of woman. Again, that's what you see, that's what your mind kind of records as you go through it. If you're pretty, if you want to be pretty, that's your place is here with men. If you're good, if you're a wife, then your place is with pigs. Ugly, fat, and happy. Okay, then that's the song we're going to have a look at. So Belle comes to the beast, to his palace, to save her father. So she comes to the beast instead of her father. She stays there. The beast isn't polite. She's unhappy. And these guys, little servants, enchanted servants, want to cheer her up a little bit because they believe that she's the only one who can lift the curse from the beast. So they want to keep her cheerful. They make this feast for her. We'll talk about it. We'll have a look
Okay.
at it. And of course, you need a bright scene. You need a bright scene because right next to it, you have one after one a few very dark scenes when she, after this banquet, she goes into the darkest part of the palace and she finds that special rose, and the beast comes. He's like, no, you should never come here. It frightens her. You can see he's a pretty boy.
Oh, yeah.
So she runs away, meets some real life. Because he's like, oh, I only read books. I'm all reading books. So now she meets some real life with a pack of wolves. They're nearly finishing her, but of course the beast comes and saves her, and he gets hurt in the process, so she decides to stay and to help him. Then the usual story, fairy tale, moonshine. Then you have this. if you can believe it. So, and then you have Gaston coming to the palace, and then of course they have a fight with the beast. And Gaston, of course, he falls from the roof. It's such a commonplace. It's in so many films use it, the bad guy falling from the roof, because it's the cleanest way to get rid of the villain. Because you need to kill him, but you can't have the good hero killing him, because if the good hero kills someone, means he's not good. But if they have a fight somewhere on the roof and the villain falls down, then it's his own fault. And you can't see the dead body if he falls from the roof. So it's a nice clean way of finishing the bad guy. And then of course there's the kiss and all happy. So meanwhile we have some more interesting moments. Again, not just in that film, in many films. So same as we had a man staring at a woman's boobies in the beginning, same as we had those happy blondies, again showing their more or less private parts to Gaston. Same thing happens in the castle. You can see here they're not human, but it's quite obvious what's happening. Just look at that smug face of the maid. And then when they do become humans again, it's like again there's a pretty girl with the big boobs being all cheeky flirty. You can say it's France, but really. So I don't know, there's something strange about that cartoon, and there's some other cartoons too. So people watch them, children watch them, and not paying much attention to like the details, but we all know that the devil is in details. So let's see the song. So it's like a very famous song, and maybe it's one of the most recognizable songs of Disney. Because there are lots of Disney songs, but that's the one that most people seem to know. Okay, let's. Can you hear?
It is with deepest pride,
yes,
and greatest pleasure that we welcome you tonight. And now, we invite you to relax, just pull up a chair, as the dining room proudly presents your dinner. Be our guest. Put our service to the test. Tie your napkin round your neck, sherry, and we provide the rest. Soup du jour, hot hors d'oeuvre. Why, we only live to serve. Try the gray stuff, it's delicious. Don't believe me? Ask the dishes. They can sing, they can dance. After all, miss, this is France. And a dinner here is never second best. Go on, unfold your menu, take a glance, and then you'll be our guest. We our guest, be our guest. Beef ragout, cheese souffle, pie and pudding on flambé. We'll prepare and serve with flair a culinary cabaret. You're alone and you're scared, but the banquet's all prepared. No one's gloomy or complaining, while the flatware's entertaining. We tell jokes, I do tricks with my fellow candlesticks.
Put it all in working face that you can bear.
Come on and lift your glass, you've won your entree pass to be our guest. If you're stressed, it's fine dining, we suggest. Be our guest, be our guest, be our guest. Life is so unnerving for a servant who's not serving. He's not whole without a soul to wait upon. Ah, those good old days when we were useful. Suddenly those good old days are gone. 10 years we've been rusting, needing so much more than dusting, needing exercise, a chance to use our skill. Most days we just lay around the castle, Flabby, fat, and lazy, you walked in and oops, a daisy!
It's a guest, it's a guest, sakes alive, rather blessed. Wise and poor, and thank the Lord, I bet the napkin's freshly pressed. With dessert, she'll want tea, and my dear, that's fine with me. While the cups do their sauce chewing, I'll be cutting and I'll be brewing. I'll get warm, fat, and hot. Heaven's sakes, is that a spot? Clean it up, we want the company impressed. We've got a lot to do. Is it one love or two? For you, I guess. She's our guest.
So what's your impression?
Well, I'm glad I haven't seen it before today's meeting. It seems I haven't missed much my life. They say this is France. What I can say, this is definitely not France, because they seem to be lacking something which is recognizably French. Probably it's because of the language, because you sing in English while pretending to be French.
Yeah,
you try
use some French words.
They use some French words.
And you can't do it in French if you're
trying to imitate the accent.
Mm-hmm.
And again, they only use the words, the French words, that have found their way into English.
Mm-hmm. And then again, it's obviously, it's like, how can you do it in French if it's for English-speaking people? I suppose it's a translation.
There's something there's something messy about it.
Mm-hmm.
It all looks like a huge mess of things, people who were turned into things, people who are happy to serve. Why are they happy to serve? I don't know. And so on. And again, I'm not someone who specializes in France and French cuisine and
It doesn't matter if it's France or Norway or
if we say that it's because it's France and French males are they look the way Gaston looks, or they look the Beast used to look before he became the Beast, and so on. It's not really true. They don't. And usually what you have about charming people is charm.
Mm-hmm.
This is these people or characters or things really like that.
Yes.
And It is both true for the servants singing their songs, singing some stupid songs, I would say. And it's also true for the lady,
yes,
who's the center of attention. She doesn't really, well, she might look beautiful to some people, but she doesn't really look charming, because charm is something that you can't really explain. If you can, then it's not charm, but something else. This is why. So, and again, we might see lots of women, if we are talking about women, something that's, well, I don't know, maybe we shouldn't discuss, but if we talk about women who look nice, they might reflect somebody's idea of beauty, of what beauty constitutes. So there are certain parameters that these...
Okay, we don't really care if she's beautiful or...
I know, I mean, so there's something, there's something that the entire movie lacks, and that something is the beauty.
Mm-hmm.
It's in the title, but it's something that, it's lost on me. Another thing I can't say is not directly connected to the song, but maybe mm-hmm. I shouldn't divert mm-hmm. our attention away from the song. I can probably mention this later if I remember.
Okay, what did you want to say?
No, it is not directly connected to the song. It's connected to the beast.
You just tell me, or you may forget it. Mm-hmm. So what's with the beast?
Yes.
What's with the beast?
Well, the thing with the beast, the thing that is wrong with the beast, is that the beast is the beast.
Mm-hmm.
As far as I remember, there's this famous Russian version, only famous in Russia, of course,
mm-hmm.
Where the beast never really appears. In fact,
uh-huh.
as far as I remember, what he does all the time, he hides from the lady's
mm-hmm.
view.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't really think he wants to impress her in the way somebody who is American can impress her by buying her beautiful gifts, by providing beautiful dinners. He does that. But what he does, what he needs, is something much more special, something that can't be readily bought or sold.
Uh-huh.
That's why he remains a very human character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a very big difference between the two. It's a very big difference indeed.
Yeah.
Because the Russian so-called beast, he knows who he is, what he is, and he is self-conscious. While this beast is just like Gaston, like, okay, I'm cool as I am, I'm big and strong, that's enough. But he has his kind of thoughts, but not really. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And again, I think the very title, again, I'm not sure about the French version. Maybe they also use this beauty and the beast opposition. But it's interesting that, as you remarked, the so-called beast is not part of the title, and there is no opposition between the beauty
mm-hmm.
and the beast. Probably because very often the beauty and the beast, especially in the world we live in today, might entail might produce some pictures of a beautiful wife and a rich and powerful man who is not at all beautiful, and she only marries him because he is rich, and so on. Or it might produce an image of someone really old
mm-hmm.
Who is married to a young woman, something which often I think
okay, we are drifting away a little bit. It doesn't really
I mean, so it's the what I was saying was The very title of the story is also sort of degrading to both the lady and the would-be man who is now the beast.
Yeah, obviously, if you put two words together, they affect each other. So as much as the beauty affects the beast affects the beauty. Yeah, that's true. So let's now focus more on the particular bit of that film, which is the song. Again, why would it be so famous? We have lots of songs. What is it? What is it about that song? So like we...
What do you think makes it special?
Oh, I'll tell you what makes it special. It's not really special, but... Also, we can see that the film has some strange ideas to show children.
Oh, yeah.
So, I guess that's another one. And again, it's not... it's not one-dimensional. There are, again, different ways of looking at it. Many different ways. So, on one hand, there's nothing wrong with it, because if you have a little cake for your, I don't know, for your birthday or something, why not? Yeah, we all enjoy our little dessert.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's like
some
nice
even
and
enjoy
happy.
Our big dessert.
Mm-hmm. But here is a big, like just feast of gluttony. So we have something which is like a cult of food these days. It's really, well, maybe it's not strange, of course. But you would expect it in like times when food is scarce. So if you have food, you're happy. Yeah, so we still have it. It's like not a problem if you want to celebrate, then the first thing that people think about is food. Oh, let's celebrate. Oh, well, what are we going to eat or drink? That's the first thing that people think. Which, again, is not obvious. It doesn't have to be that way. You don't have to eat and eat and eat just to celebrate something. In fact, it's a very weird way of celebrating, doing yourself harm by eating too much or eating something unhealthy, which is what people usually eat for holidays. Well, special occasions. But okay, let's say having a little cake now and then, there's nothing wrong with it. But there's a real cult of food when people post pictures of their food on the internet, like it's the most interesting thing to look at. Again, maybe you can say, oh, but the cake is like a piece of art, it's beautifully made, so we want to show it not as food, but as a piece of art. Okay, maybe, but if that was just beautiful cakes, but it's anything.
Sorry for the interrupt. Yeah, but again, do these cakes really look attractive?
Well, to some people. Oh.
So to some people, because this looks like plastic to me.
It does. Maybe it is plastic.
The first picture where she is confronted with a cake and some ice creams or I don't know souffles, something is yes this picture. It looks. Some of the things in the picture look like wild mushrooms to me. And
oh,
again,
do they? Interesting.
These poisonous mushrooms that might look.
Well, it's just
very,
bright colors, but yes, of course, all
yeah,
these things
bright,
are really bright colors and natural.
But again, it's there's really something that. Yes, and you mentioned the cult of food, both in the film and in our culture today. And again,
which is why it's in the film.
Hmm?
Which is why it's in the film and why it made such a big impact, because we are already ready to accept it, I guess. people are ready to get to it. And people who make the film, they know it, so they play on it. They make it big.
Yeah. And they also make it preposterous, because all of this looks preposterous. Again, I don't know anyone who lives in a castle and has grand dinners, but I've been to France, I've seen French food, and it doesn't look, you know, something like
no,
this.
It's tiny.
And I read a book, I read a book, which is written by a Russian priest in America, a Russian Orthodox priest in America, who was born in Russia, but whose parents spent lots of time.
Well, we don't really care if it's in France or not in France, because people watch it everywhere.
There's something, what he says is, a thing that characterizes Americans' attitude to food is that they make so much fuss about it, unlike the French. So if Americans discover a French custom, they make a lot of fuss about it. The French just eat wine and cheese because it's good to have wine and cheese. The Americans have a lot of fuss about it. They try and do this and that, and they
maybe that's where it started. Maybe that's where it started, because I don't think that we originally had this big cult of food in like Britain, Europe, Russia. Maybe it started in America, and then you have all these images and cartoons and ideas, and they're just spreading. So now we have it everywhere. Again, it's where do you direct your attention? You direct your attention to boobs and to food. So again, it's a very primitive lens. And it's put into your mind since like early childhood. Then again, we have all these alcohol, apparently. Champagne and beer. Don't tell me it's not alcoholic. Could be, but doesn't look like it. So, what is interesting about all those images, if we talk about the visual part, then you can see a lot of food is shown to her, but she's not really allowed to have any. She can dip her finger here and there. She never has a real bite. So it's all an illusion. It's all fairy food. It's glamour. It's not real. So they show you all that colorful, plentiful, abundant stuff. Just look at his face. Here, have some champagne, have some alcohol. Oh dear, but they're only showing, they're never giving. Yeah, that's one of the tricks here. So if you look at the text,
the text of the song.
The text of the song, So it's all about food, okay? So again, as a song, there isn't much to like analyze, because so be our guest, put a service to the test. So we begin again, a guest and service, servant. So that's two subjects here. Yeah. One is you are our guest, we have lots of things for you, and it's all food. Again, if they want to have a happy scene before going to the dark place, does it have to be food? Maybe it doesn't have to be food.
No.
Could be flowers.
No, not at all.
Could be flowers, could be anything, could be music.
Yeah.
But they decide to make it with food and lots of food. I mean, it's for one person. That's all these huge cakes and dishes. It's all for one person. and she never gets any anyway. So, tie your napkin around your neck. Interesting, again interesting. So in the very beginning, we're tying something around your neck. So it kind of innocent if you speak about napkins, but then again, you're not supposed to tie it around your neck to start with. The etiquette is to put it on your lap, to put it on your knees, and not to tie it around your neck. So what happens if you tie something around your neck? What is the image, the meaning of it?
You start playing the hangman, or the hanged woman.
Yeah. So either you're about to be, killed, you'll be dead, or another way, just like, you're in somebody's power. So it's like a collar. Could be like a collar, like a slave, like a dog, or something around your neck. You're not in power. And that's how the song begins. They say they're your servants, but really, you are in their power. And they have lots of things to offer you, and it's all bright and colorful, but none of it is real. Sounds familiar, huh? The idea. Okay. Tie your napkin around your neck, Sherry. So it's something that they offer you, and you accept or do not accept it. But of course, if it's a song, then the idea of it, it's like a spell. It's it bespells you, and you stop thinking, and you just do what they tell you without noticing. We provide the rest, then soup and starters. We only live to serve. So, who are they? What are they? What's the message? Saying on one hand,
On the one hand, yeah.
Yeah, so on one hand, it's like saying that there are people who are like second class, who live to serve other people. Who are not fully human. So you are human, you are that girl, but they're not people. So you see the same characters time and again. It's not just one dish, lots of dishes, not just one feather duster, but lots of them, they all look the same. So they're all servants. Each dish is a person, but they all look the same. Each mug is a person, they all look the same. Each napkin is a person turned into a thing, but they all look the same. So what it tells you that servants are like second class people who all look the same, they don't have a face. Even that girl, she's not unique. You can see there's just
she isn't she's someone who responds
you wouldn't know parameters. You wouldn't know her from any other of her kind. Again, they're all the same. So is it a good lesson? Is it what we want to learn?
Well, it is a good lesson to someone who can learn the lesson, who can analyze it. But, of course, again, it isn't French at all. French waiters are not really servants. They have their own say. They often have their own say. They act like real people. And that might be even unique to France. Again, that's not really important, but the important thing is, as you said, we act on these oppositions. So there's the beauty and the beast, the opposition that appears in the title. There's servant, beautiful there's a servant and beautiful hostess of position in the grand dinner, in the grand dinner scene. This beautiful girl, ugly wife, beautiful girl, ugly hard-working man of position in the picture you are showing now.
Yeah, so that's really the same idea. There are people who are working class, working hard. It could be servants in the castle, could be people in the town, and they are all second class. Either they all look the same, they have no face, or they're all ugly, fat and happy. And there's only one girl who's all in white, and that's the girl you should think you are. Because she's the main character. So that's
someone you can identify
with. Like, it kind of teaches you that you are above the crowd. There is a crowd, one, and two, that you're above it. That you are better than other, well, maybe you're better than other people, but then other people are better than you too. So...
Yeah, and again, speaking of that, you might be better than some other people, but as long as you start thinking that you are better, then
you are never better, because there's always somebody who's better than you.
There's always somebody who's better than you.
There's no limit.
There's no limit to that, and also I do really think it's, well, if you think, okay, this man is stupid, this man is bad, this is a hard-working man, a member of the labor class, and he smells bad, well, immediately as that idea comes into your mind and think, I'm superior to him, I'm superior to her, I'm superior to this poor, again, sorry, it's the same thing with me, I'm superior to this poor beggar in the street because I'm not poor to be begging in the street and I wear clean clothes. The moment I have this idea, I'm in trouble because I'm no longer good.
I mean, it's always around. It always seems to be around. Maybe it's just like a part of our culture, let's say. Because it's the same. You look at, I don't know, really it's like imperial thinking. If you are British or from the British Empire, then like Italians are not people to you. If you're a Victorian, like, then children are not people to you. If you're in today's Russia, then Tajiki, Uzbeki are not people to you. It's awful how they're treated. They're not treated like people, they're not even treated like animals. So it's the same kind of thinking, that the people, there are people who are all the same. People who can be interchangeable. People like made on factory, the same. So
yeah, on the assembly line,
so it's the same in today's Russia as before.
Well, in the coronavirus outbreak situation that we have here, I've seen well, there's official lockdown of some sort. But I've seen these Tajiki or Uzbek people being driven in dirty buses, in dusty buses, from their construction sites to the place where they live. And I'm certain that they didn't do social distancing in the bus because
I have seen it too. I have seen it, in the middle of all that madness, and everybody sits at home, and I look out of my window, and I can see, well, not out of my window, but like, But I can see there are all these Tajiki Uzbeki, very no mask, nothing, what they're supposed to be doing, and they're like painting the fence. That's the most important thing during the outbreak, to paint the fence. Yeah. I mean, you have stories, like a friend of mine told me how he saw it too, how these people worked on a construction site, and they had nothing. They ate what they could find, or just anywhere, in the rubbish. And if somebody died, then nobody cared. Like, we have more, they're all the same, they're interchangeable. So we forget that each person is unique and amazing, as they are. It doesn't matter if they're Tajiki, Uzbeki, British. But here we have that idea in the cartoon, really reflected, and there's this crazy bit when the plates and things just multiply and multiply, and there are billions and millions of them, they're all the same. Yeah, here.
Yeah.
And you just remember that each one is a person.
And again, it's stupid because in the good old days, they made deliberate efforts at producing plates that look different from mm-hmm. each other, that look beautiful
yeah.
and unique. And it's nothing compared to mass production that we have today.
Well, and that is a part of today's thinking, I agree. Because, yeah, really, in old times, each thing was unique. Even if you got it from like IKEA, you would paint it, you would change it somehow, so it would be only yours. But now we have like building blocks of flats, big square boxes with flats that are all the same. And that's really, that's the same idea that came. The architecture reflects thinking. That came from the same idea that people should be all the same. So you live in boxes which are all the same, and you have things which are all the same. Okay, so back to the text. Tie your napkin around your neck, we'll provide the rest, we only live to serve. Oh dear, oh dear. Try the grey stuff, it's delicious. Try the grey
stuff.
They don't know what it is, you don't know what it is, but they say it's delicious and you try it. Do you think grey stuff is delicious? It could be, but that's not what we think if we hear grey stuff. What is it, brains? It's some brains. So try the grey stuff.
Little grey cells.
Mm-hmm. So they show you all these colorful images, but they only offer you gray stuff. And you don't even know what it is. You don't even know what it is. Just gray stuff. It's delicious. Don't believe me, ask the dishes. They can sing, they can dance. After all, miss, that is France. And the dinner here is never second best. So again, we'll entertain you. We'll sing for you, we'll dance for you. You'll never notice what we are really doing to you. Oh, whether it's France or not really. And again, focusing on dinner, food. So you want to be happy, you have food. Go on, unfold your menu, take a glance, and then you'll be our guest.
And I'm just looking through the text they use is, of course, something that is obvious, something that might be obvious to the kids who watch the movie or to their parents if the kids have trouble understanding what soup du jour means.
Well, we don't need to understand it. We only need to know that it's all food, 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 food under different names. It's all food and food and food. They show you what it is. They show you what it is, kind of briefly. So we are stuffed with food. And it's really there. So they, each time they name food, especially they show it, obviously, there's more and more and more. It's more than you need. It's much more than you can take. And it's there. It's quite obvious. What happens is, let's see, where is it? Menu. When they come to the pie, when they come to the pie, here, what is it? What is that pie? Oh. This one, which he says, pudding and flambé. So it's really a coffin. It's a coffin. And really, because it might not look like a coffin the first time you look at it, but it kind of might. But then that's what you have. Yeah, we have the guy inside it, baked into it, and then what? He's cremated. You see? He falls into it, and it's a coffin. They take him out. It's like a coffin. It's a food which kills you. A food which is supposed to sustain you. You have too much. It kills you. And they show it. Literally, they show it that it's a coffin. It's not a plate. It's a coffin. Yeah. And it's not really funny. Because at the same time, they're showing you plainly what they really mean here. At the same time, we are overlooking it. Because we have too much. Things on things on things. Yeah?
Yeah. Well, this looks like a spaceship. But it's also interesting that it all looks like a theater of some sort, mm-hmm. or a circus.
Mm-hmm. Well, they say cabaret.
These flashlights.
They say it's a cabaret. Again, it's not a theater, it's a cabaret, which is a bit different, which is closer to. Where was that girl? Yeah.
Yeah.
A cabaret is closer to those sexy girls who are showing their knickers somewhere. Where was it? Well, you remember?
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah. So that's cabaret.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's not what a decent person would go to see. Again.
And it's not, again, there's lots of food that you are sort of offered. But then it's absolutely crazy to have a huge table, to sit at the head of the table, to be seated there, and to have no one else to join the dinner with you. To just be sitting there, the only human, because we suppose that all these servants are second class.
They're things, literally. So things. Servants are literally things.
And wouldn't someone normal feel a bit not okay, a bit uncomfortable sitting in a beautiful or something that looks like beautiful hall at the head of the huge table? Again, why is she seated at the head? I don't know.
There's no one else, and she's their guest.
And
again, if they want you to do it, they will do anything to flatter you.
Oh, yeah, but again, it's, I think most people, if we imagine a scene. It's a castle, it's an old castle. There's a dining room, and there's a big table in the dining room. And you sit alone. Then it is something that rather reminds us of horror movies than something happy and bright.
Well, it is. That's the idea, that she walks into a horror movie and makes it all flowers and butterflies. Actually. But yeah. So for her, maybe it's more like a show. So she doesn't think like, oh, I'm alone sitting here eating, because she's not eating. She's only shown food. She's not eating. She's not having anything at all. So maybe that's not that bad for her. Okay. So, and then we have something very, very important. We have those two really important lines. You're alone and you're scared. So that is something real. That is what is really happening. That's the truth. That when the glamour is washed away, that's what is left. She's alone and she is scared. But she never gets to kind of look at it, because immediately it's drowned in food. So it's like, for 1 second, your real reality, your real position, you're alone and you're scared, you are in trouble. Yeah? You're not happy, you're in trouble. For 1 second, we have a glance at it, and then it disappears again, because you're suffocated in all that food and entertainment. You literally have no space, there's no pause, it's like a mad, it's going quicker and quicker and faster, things on things and things on things. You never get a little tiny pause just to understand, just to look at yourself. Yeah, you're alone and you're scared, that's the most important bit in the whole scene, in the whole song. But it's immediately hidden. Yeah. So we don't have time to stop and think about it. We don't have time to stop and reflect on it. We are distracted immediately by more and more and more food. But yeah, the bank is all prepared. No one's gloomy or complaining. Mm-hmm. And entertaining.
And it's probably true for many people today. They feel alone and lonely, they feel scared, and then they are offered something to sort of distract them from.
Well, yeah, that is what happens things all the time. That's the easy way out. It's an easy way out. So, I feel unhappy, I'll go and watch a kamedze and have some food. Oh, sure, it will make me feel better. Maybe it will, but for a second, for a minute, for an hour, it will not solve any problems. Oh, that's what people don't understand, is that you can dull it for a second. You can never feel it, no matter how much food you put into it, no matter how much entertainment, because it's nothing. You have a
and then
big...
again, you remain alone. Because what you are feeling is, you're alone, you are scared, but no one else is. Because the banquet is all prepared. No one's gloomy or complaining, you shouldn't complain.
Yeah.
While the flatware's entertaining. Jokes, tricks, that's, and again the word trick is, in the context of what just been discussed, the word doing tricks is very is very telling, I would say. Yeah, so again, instead of being part of a sort of a brotherhood, sisterhood, where you get real support, you're made part of a culinary cabaret, and you are just diverted from what your real troubles might be, but you never really feel connected to the things that are entertaining you, because the only thing that's important to them is to be entertaining. No complaints, no gloomy feelings, but just jokes that might seem silly. Again, if you are lucky, you might find someone who tells smart jokes. Tricks, again, silly tricks in the movie, but again, depending on how much you're willing to pay, you might find entertainment that involves something nicer. But so instead of going to a cabaret, you might go to a nice restaurant to be diverted from something. And again, well, the problem, I wanted to ask you something about what you said. The diversions don't really work, as you mentioned, because they really bad. Is there a way out? Is there something or someone who can relieve the pain?
Oh, yeah, surely. The crown virus. The crown virus, which I mean the isolation. Isolation, that thing is really good. I really enjoy it because it's like, it's perfect. Finally, you can be a little bit like a hermit, and finally you can have time to look at yourself. Again, you may choose to watch comedies all day long, if that's all you can do. Why not? I mean, we all have our way to go. It doesn't have to be the same. But you may use that time like to look at yourself, to use the silence.
Counter with yourself.
Okay. To use the silence, to listen to the silence when finally you have that space. Finally, the whole world, more or less, can experience this beautiful state, which like usually was only available to some monks who live on their own, hermits. Yeah, because even monks in the monastery, usually there's a small community or a big community. But if you sit in your flat, maybe you have some members of your family, maybe not. Maybe you have some pets, maybe not. Yeah?
And in case people are all alone, they are real hermits, or so it seems.
Cole, you may live on your own and not be a hermit, because you go out and meet with your friends, and you talk to everybody, and you're Skyping and chatting. It's still there. But you can use it to just go really deep into it, to explore it. Again, like I say, it's the same as 40 years in the desert with Moses. It's the same as 40 days in the desert with Jesus. It's the same as 40 years with, who was it? Mary of Egypt. Yeah. So it's perfect. It's amazing. It's really, really good.
Or maybe it's just because you are left alone at this huge table with no one to sing songs to you and tell you jokes and do all the tricks, and you finally sense that you are empty inside. You only exist if there's someone else to entertain you. You can't survive if you are left all alone to contemplate silence. I don't know. So what seems to me is that many of us are not really prepared for that sort of
No, but nobody's asked, really.
Because
When it's time, it's time. Nobody's asked. You just go for it. You do what you can do. Nobody says you should become a real hermit. But you do what you can do at whatever level you can do it. It doesn't matter if you're an advanced, I don't know, medium spiritual, so-called spiritual person, and you're meditating every day. It doesn't matter. Or if you are a napkin or a candlestick. It doesn't matter. You do what you can do. It's the same. It's exactly the same like the last time we said about layers of poetry. Each layer has something to tell you. It doesn't matter. If you don't know anything about Psalms, you still listen to it. You still get your message. If you know a little bit, you maybe get another message. If you know the whole Holy Scripture by heart, then you get yet another message. But they're all valid messages. It's not like if you know all Scripture by heart, then your message is better. It's just different. The same here. Everybody gets a message at this time. It can be different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and as I said, as I've said many times, it seems that we all take many things for granted.
Indeed.
Things that are really gifts. And when we are deprived of these things, mm-hmm. which we discover that they do really matter, they are not just there, they are given to us. Maybe even they are not really things, because our existence is not a thing, it's something else. I don't know. But, well, maybe that's what the coronavirus, maybe that's the lesson the coronavirus is teaching me. Maybe it's just there to stop complaining if you are able to live as we were able to live before the involuntary confinement.
Oh, come on, I mean, like, look at people on submarines who go out into the sea for a year. They're not complaining. Okay, now let's have a little break. And then we'll continue.
Okay.